Playing around with aged computer components elicits two fulfilling emotions. One is nostalgia, the other is contentment. The latter stems from the ability to make a 10-year-old graphics card run modern demanding PC games at very high frames by any means necessary, even that means that it will make your eyes bleed from relentless overpixelation. The graphics card I'm referring to is NVIDIA's GeForce GTX 750 Ti, a groundbreaking product from 2014 which combined good performance and low power consumption at a very affordable price. It was the golden standard entry-level GPU for upgrading office PCs and introducing newcomers into the world of PC gaming. However, today with only 2GB of VRAM, the GTX 750 Ti is considered outdated and definitely not seen as a viable option for modern gaming. Despite that, it still holds a special place in my heart, as well as in the hearts of many gamers and tech enthusiasts. Moreover, NVIDIA's Maxwell architecture, the technology behind the GTX 750 Ti, is still supported with the latest drivers updates. This gives a glimmer of hope that this decade-old graphics card might be able to handle a couple of modern PC games. The plan is to overclock the card's core and memory clock frequency, adjust the fan speed accordingly, and drastically lowering games graphics by any means necessary to work around the graphics card's limited VRAM. All the tests will initially begin at 1080p resolution, since, accordingly to my empirical observation, it is the most common choice for people to play games with low-budget cards. Just for the kicks and giggles, the final goal is to achieve the highest possible number of frames depending on the game. However, before reaching that point, I will also demonstrate a few in-between options that won't have your eyeballs filing for divorce. It's worth noting that single-player games generally don't need more than 60 frames per second to deliver a satisfying game experience. On the other hand, competitive multiplayer games demand higher FPS for better responsiveness and consequently higher win rates. The benchmarking suite will set off with a bunch of modern AAA titles before moving to a more lightweight but still popular PC games. All the benchmarks will run on my old but not obsolete M4 system, paired with a Ryzen 5800X CPU and 32GB of DDR4 RAM running on a fresh installation of Microsoft Windows 10. With that out of the way, allow me to begin with the... You see, while the version of GeForce GTX 750 Ti I am using supports DirectX 12, it's only up to feature level 11. As a result, Elden Ring, RoboCop Rogue City, and Ghost of Tsushima crashed seconds after launching, short like my marriage. Oh well, with that out of my chest, let's finally talk about the...
Ah, shit! Here we go again.
First of all, can we appreciate the fact that the GTX 750 Ti is able to launch Alan Wake 2 despite the initial scary warning message? Can we also completely awestruck by the miracle that this little marvel can run a game where other more recent graphics cards are dying from video memory asphyxiation and crash to desktop? Does it matter if I'm struck by a seizure while watching the 750 Ti having epileptic shocks while struggling to run Alan Wake 2 on PowerPoint? No, because I can do better by enabling FSR 2.0 at ultra performance and with that triple the amount of frames. And since I'm feeling tipsy from all these relatively higher frames per second, I can tweak a few configuration files and lower the video quality even further, achieving an average of 13 frames per second. Still, very low numbers for smooth gameplay, but fair enough to immerse myself in the story, since we all know that it's not the graphics that makes or breaks a game, but rather the overall gameplay experience itself.
Make sure I'm seeing the clues clearly.
That might be a bit difficult. What might not be difficult is to guess the next game, which even at low video settings and 1080p resolution, it looks pretty good, although the frame rate barely reaches the low 20s, and that's not so good. I'm not saying that this isn't impressive for a card like 750 Ti. However, it can do better at 1024x760 window mode, a resolution that I wouldn't mind to play Cyberpunk 2077, still looks beautiful and the frame rate mostly stays above mid-30s. Quite acceptable FPS for a single-player game. Now, if upon this you use a performance-boosting mod and apply FSR, you will unlock a secret expansion called Potato Punk 2077, where a new global government has downgraded everyone's neural chips, replacing them with a GTX 750 Ti. At the same time, scalpers have hoarded all the stock of minoxidil, while, mysteriously, the folk of Night City overnight lost all of the hair on their scalps, of course. What a strange coincidence, don't you think? Another strange phenomenon is the transformation of Tekken 8 into turn-based beat-em-up, running at 1080p and low settings. A drop to 720p and gets faster, but not quite in sync with the game's locked frame rate. In fact, I had to crank down the rendering scale setting to a measly 25% just to hit constantly 60 frames per second. If you go down this route, don't forget at the end to clean your screen from the digital smut by exit the game. Even in the relatively lightweight beginning of the demo in Resident Evil 4, the GTX 750 Ti struggles to keep the frame rate above 30. FSR cannot save it. So why we don't go straight to the glorious 48 resolution and enjoy 4 times the frames per second? Don't mind about the constant floating flies in your eyes. There is nothing wrong with your vision. It's just inside the game, for the moment being at least. But play long enough at this resolution, and who knows, you might start seeing them in the real life too. If you want to make the flies disappear, you can enable ultra performance FSR, but in terms of visuals, this is definitely a game dead end. The benchmark of Far Cry 6 at 1080p on lowest settings barely hits 30fps, resulting in a big red VRAM warning at the end. Enabling FSR somehow drops the frames further, and 720 resolution doesn't change things much. So, as an act of desperation, scaling the resolution at half might solve the low frame rates, but the rendering graphics will be a far cry from the developer's intended visual fidelity. Forza Horizon 5 is the only modern game among the so-called major studio releases that the 750 Ti can hit an average of 60 frames per second at 1080p resolution with very low settings. If you find this performance insufficient, I suggest selecting 1280 by 960 window mode resolution and enable FXAA. This should increase your average frame rate to 83, with 1% low staying well above 60. Forza Horizon 5 deserves significant praise as one of the few well-optimized titles in the market. No sudden frame drops, not a peep or any nagging about low VRAM. Despite the theme of this video, I won't abuse this game anymore as a sign of respect. On the other hand, Fortnite is the definition of unoptimization, and it contains a plethora of settings to abuse as much as I want. Unfortunately, DirectX 12 on GTX 750 Ti is not available anymore, so we have either DirectX 11, which offers at 1080p somewhat playable frames, but clearly not enough for our pro battle royale skills, or we can choose performance mode that averages well above 100 frames per second, but it does terribly with 1% lows, generating plenty of micro stutters. Dropping the resolution to 720 significantly straights the frame time graph and nearly doubles the overall performance, striking a perfect balance between acceptable visuals and high frame numbers. If you don't mind much about the longevity of your eyeballs, you can always lower the 3D resolution and brag to your friends that you play Fortnite at 500fps on your GTX 750 Ti. Meanwhile, you will not be able to use the same bragging right playing Apex Legends on a 750 Ti, because it will miss the golden 60fps mark more often than it should. I wouldn't call it completely unplayable, but that's coming from someone who usually dies in the first few minutes of gameplay and then spectates the rest of the match. Competitive players will need for sure to drop the resolution to 720 and tweak a config file to maintain acceptable frame rates and smoother frame times. The real challenge here is whether they can still spot opponents in this pixelated chaos. CS2 and high frame rates on old GPUs is a far gone dream. These days, you will be lucky if you can squeeze 60fps out of it using a GTX 750 Ti. Furthermore, if you are aiming for competitive play, the once upon a time optional 720p windowed mode is now a must. Enabling FSR will offer more frames and acute eye strain. Beyond the eye-gouging jokes and shifting to a more serious tone, I will wrap up by saying that NVIDIA's GTX 750 Ti was indeed a reliable 1080p GPU 10 years ago. Its incredibly low power consumption made it a fantastic entry-level upgrade for any office or small form factor computer, as well as for gamers who wanted to play modern titles without expecting to max out the video settings such as the GTA 5 that you are watching just now on your screen. However, in 2024, and despite its feisty spirit, the GTX 750 Ti can barely run esports titles at 1080p, so expecting this car to handle current heavyweight games, it's a fool's errand. Today, I will classify the 750 Ti as a solid 720p performer for Battle Royale and overall any modern low-spec PC game. It's also a great keep if you enjoy revisiting titles that developed before 2016-2017, playing at low to medium settings and 1080p resolution. If you own a GTX 750 Ti, my top 2 suggestions are to overclock it for a free 10-30% performance boost, always depending on the game, and if you have to play at 720p, prefer windowed mode to minimize the visual quality loss that low upscaled resolutions usually cause. One more important thing, if you enjoyed this nostalgic and hopefully entertaining journey revisiting the legendary GTX 750 Ti, you might also like a video I made about the GTX 1050 Ti during the scalpers pandemic era.